1 Peter chapter 2, we're going to focus on verses 13 through 17 today. I'm going to start back in 11. I usually try to start with a couple of verses before. Jar our memory from last week. Peter says, "Beloved," meaning the brethren, the church, the believers, the people who are called by God, "Beloved, I urge you as sojourners," you're foreigners in this land, exiles from heaven on earth. He's urging us and he urged them to abstain. Abstain means to abstain. It doesn't mean to play with. It doesn't mean to toy with. It doesn't mean to flirt with. It means to abstain from what? From passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Those are strong words. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles. Keep your conduct among non-believers, among those who are outside the church. Keep your conduct honorable, so that when they speak against you, and they will, as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation, when the Lord returns. Jesus said the same things. You know, don't take your light and put it under a basket. You put it on a hill. You let the people see what you do and glorify the Father. The key is the motivation. Are you doing good things, good deeds, honorable conduct, so that you're seen by men and therefore you are glorified? Or is it for one thing and one thing only, and that is to glorify God, who is worthy of our praises? So do this, right? Now, verse 13. "Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you shall put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the emperor." Now, if you remember 1 Peter, Peter the apostle is writing a letter to Christians in Asia Minor who have been dispersed. They're scattered, like if you take salt and you scatter it across a black velvet thing on the ground there, you would see them. They're dispersed, they're scattered, the little salt. Christians were scattered. They were being persecuted. Why? Because in that culture, to say that there is only one God, and there is only one way, one truth, one life, and his name is Jesus Christ, that was to be completely countercultural, because in a pagan culture, there are many gods. Many gods. And one of the central gods for them was Caesar himself. And to say that, no, he is not God, he is a mere man, the only God is Yahweh, the triune God, is all of a sudden to become countercultural. You cannot buy, you cannot sell. You're fired from your job, and in many cases, you're killed. Now, some people believe that Peter wrote this letter soon after Nero set fire to Rome on purpose. He set fire to Rome because he was completely self-centered, an egotistical narcissist who loved himself so much, he loved to build things. Well, Rome was already built. So he thought, hey, I know what I'll do. I'll burn half of Rome and then I'll rebuild it. Well, that didn't get him very liked with the people. So then he thought of a great plan. Well, I'll just blame it on the Christians. I'll blame this fire on the Christians. And he did. And so the people got behind Rome when they started taking Christians and murdering them and taking them alive and covering them in black tar and pitch and putting them on a pole and setting them on fire to be the streetlights in Rome. The people supported this, just like the Germans and the Nazis supported the killing and slaughtering of innocent Jews. People are evil, and they're easily manipulated. Well, I don't think that Peter wrote this letter after that happened. I think he wrote it right before, around 63, 64 AD. But they were definitely being persecuted, without a doubt. He talks about suffering. They were coming under immense suffering, which would be a test for their faith. It would test the genuineness of their faith. And the same thing happens to us today. We go through a trial, we go through something, and what do? We blame God. How dare you? Or we just reject God. Well, if there was a God, he wouldn't allow this to happen. And therefore, our walk and our strength and how we live after and going through trials can really illuminate to our hearts exactly what we believe in our faith. Because the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1, it tests the genuineness of your faith. Just like gold and silver is brought through a fire to be refined, to be made pure. Your faith is made pure through the fiery trials of our lives. Now, chapter 1 and most of chapter 2, Peter builds the reasons for why we should endure this suffering with the facts that we were elected by God before the foundation of the world, to be chosen as his children, to be adopted into his family, that he has an inheritance in heaven kept for us, safe by the power of God the Father himself, that is imperishable, uncorruptible, that we will inherit, meaning we don't have to do anything. We get it. We participate in the glories of Christ. That's what verse 7 of chapter 2 says. So the honor is for you who believe. The honor of what? The honor of being able to stand before the king. I mean, when the king is glorified and crowned on the day of tabernacling with us, we'll be there, it says in the book of Revelation. We'll be there, sharing and basking in his glory. It's incredible. It's fascinating. So Peter, he teaches these amazing things, and he like spins around. He just keeps circling around the same truths before he transitions in verse 13 here. And what does he say? Be subject for the Lord's sake. Every human institution, whether it be the emperor as supreme or to the emperors or governors sent by him to punish those who do evil and praise those who do good. Be subject. Submit. Submission is a central theme in the New Testament. We submit unto God and his word. Right? The church submits unto Christ. Husbands, submit unto the Lord and his word. Wives, submit unto their husbands. Children, submit unto their parents. The elders, submit unto Christ and his word. The church submits unto the elders. This is all in the word of God. It's a central theme. But see, as I said earlier when we started to pray, our culture has taken this word submission and made it a word of weakness, not a word of strength. But I think here we're going to find out that it's actually strength. You see, what does it say there? We are subjects for the sake of the Lord. Verse 13, be subject for the Lord's sake. This isn't just because Peter got a wild hair and said, hey, be subject to the government. But he says, for the Lord's sake. We are subjects to every human institution. The word institution there in the Greek is really creature. Look it up. It means creature, to every human creature. What is this saying? It's saying that God ordains and forms authorities and governments. And we're going to find out why. You see, God arranged and ordained leaders and governments. And he tells us for what? Well, verse 15, for this is his will, or actually verse 14, excuse me, or by governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and silence the ignorance of foolish people. Now, governments restrain evil by keeping order and preventing anarchy. The purpose of ruling authorities is the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. And that's what it says. Verse 15, for this is the will of God, by doing good you shall put the silence of ignorant, foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants for God. Verse 14, excuse me, I'm getting confused here. I'm probably confusing you even more. Verse 14, to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. This is very important, very, very, very important, because God's will is that government would keep order and would punish evildoers and praise those who do good. And in the culture of Rome, they would do this. They would erect statues for people who would like contribute a bunch of money or different things to the community. They would praise those who would do good, and then they would come down hard on those who do bad. Now, the reason why Peter is saying this, be subject to them, is because it's very easy to become a zealot, to become rebellious, to want to overthrow the government. And in the Jewish culture, this was something that was going on. They thought the Messiah would come in as a military ruler and that they would overthrow Rome forcefully with weapons. And that's what they were looking for. Peter said, no, now is not the time. And how do we know that? Well, when they come to arrest Jesus, Peter, the one who wrote this, who said to be subject, he takes out his sword and cuts off the ear of one of the guys who comes to arrest Jesus. And Jesus says to him, don't you realize that I could call the legions of angels from heaven and wipe them all out? But Jesus subjected himself unto them. And he said that. He said, no one lays down his life because of them. I lay it down on my own accord. I have the authority to lay it down. I have the authority to take it up. We have the ability, for the Lord's sake, and because we belong to him, to choose to submit unto the government. Now, does this mean we just submit to anything and everything? Does this mean that no matter what the government does, God's will is that we would just go along with it? No, that's not what this means. Because this has to do with the standard order of things. Governments that punish those who do evil and praise those who do good. That's the context of this government and which we should be submitting unto. The theme here is that Christians should not run around being rebellious, breaking the law. Shouldn't run around rebellious, just doing anything and everything that they want to do in anarchy. No, we are to be example citizens. We are to be example to do what is right. It's against the law, folks, to participate in certain things. But yet we justify it and say, well, you know, it shouldn't be against the law. Well, who are you? Who are you to just make up in your own mind what is right and what is wrong? Here's the test. When the government ordains things that are against God's law, now we have a problem. Now we have a problem. And we have examples of this in the Bible. Daniel, he's taken out of his own land in Jerusalem, taken to a foreign land. Does he cooperate with the government authorities? Yes, he does. But he becomes disobedient when what? They tell him, you can no longer pray to your God. Now we have Houston, we have a problem. I will respect you. I will be civil to you. But I will not obey that. We have other examples. Pharaoh, Moses, right? Pharaoh pulls out the decree that all those boys need to die. And what do the nursemaids of Moses do? Do they obey that? Did they obey the order and the decree of the government? No, they did not. They put him in the river and let him live. And therefore, God's will prevailed. And what happened? Moses liberated the Jewish people. If they would have obeyed and submit to what the government wanted, that would have not happened. Look at what happened with Peter, or with John, excuse me, John and Peter, when they're walking into the temple soon after Jesus was crucified. And they come, they stumble upon the guy there who's on the ground, he's paralyzed, and he's asking for money. And Peter says, hey, money, gold and silver I don't have, but what I do have, I'll give to you. Get up and walk in the name of the Lord Jesus from Nazareth. And boy, he got up and walked. What'd the government do? They called him in. Sit down. Shut up. We forbid you to preach in the name of Jesus anymore. Hey, and he said, you decide in your own heart whether it's right for me to obey God or you. Went right back into the temple preaching in the name of Jesus Christ. There is time to be subject to the governing authorities. And there is time to stand up for God and the Word of God. And what's happened in the church, in our country, we have lost that balance. We have lost that balance. For the sake of, we don't want to ruffle any feathers. We take what liberties we did have, and we've given them away. We've given them away. They say, you know, because of our tax exemption and stuff, there's certain things I can and cannot say up here. You know what? I'll tell you what. I don't give a flip about that. And this is recorded. I don't care. I do not care. This is what I care about. There may come a day that they may march in here and take me in handcuffs. There may come a day they take you in handcuffs if you stand up for Christ and His truth. It may come, especially as we give more and more and more away. There is no law that says our children cannot pray in school or have the Bible in school, but yet we give it away. We give it away. We don't care. We don't want to ruffle any feathers. We just got to go along with the flow. The old saying goes, right? Satan, you give him an inch, he takes a mile, and he will. He will. Now, we are subject first to God, then to man. The submission is no way obsolete or absolute submission. We follow the government and the governing authorities as long as it follows along with the will of God. Esther, remember what she did? She went in, bust through the door to see the king. It could have cost her life. Seriously, it could have. All the king had to do. I mean, it put the king in jeopardy because all the people are looking to the king to keep the law. You can't just bust in and try to talk to the king. There's protocol. There's rules. There's ways about doing things. She didn't care. She didn't care if she lived or died. She trusted God and she did it. There are times to obey the government, and there are times to obey God. But our loyalty is first to God, not to Caesar. Remember Jesus? Shall we pay taxes? And he said, give me a coin. Bring me a coin. Come on, bring it up here. He gets it, and he says, whose face is on this coin? Caesar. Well then, render to Caesar what is Caesar's, and render to God what is God. You know what he did right there? A lot of people miss this. Who was Caesar in this culture? He was a god. He was a god. And so for Jesus to stand before all those people, including Roman soldiers, who could have went up and chopped his head off for this statement, he says, render to Caesar what is Caesar, render to God what is God. What he's saying is Caesar is a man. My loyalty is to God. My loyalty is to God. Now, it says, obey the supreme, the emperor, the king, right? But also the governors, okay? We are to obey the government in which we have, to an extent. I think I've tried to explain this, as long as it doesn't contradict the law of God, you know? We have a responsibility as people. Well, number one, for self-defense, too, in our own homes. I'll tell you what, if we were ever told we cannot have weapons in our own home for our own protection, this is a personal choice, guys. I'm not saying you have to do this. But what I'm saying is, that's something I would never obey, ever obey. We have a responsibility to protect ourselves, to protect our family. Why? Because there's evil in the world. There's evil. You have a TV. I mean, turn that sucker on for 2 minutes for the news. And it's just murders and killings and bombings. And I mean, it's horrible. I think we should create a good news channel. You know, all we do is good news. And we don't have to make it up. I mean, there's plenty of good news out there. Find some good news and put some stories on there. I'd love that. Wouldn't that be good? Some positive news for one. I mean, we got enough. I can't even watch this stuff. I barely can read it. Now, verse 15, 16. For this is the will of God, that by doing good, you shall put to silence the ignorant of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover up for evil, but living as servants of God. Where it says there in verse 15, for this is the will of God, some translation says, thus is the will of God. And depending on who you read, some people want to do it prospectively, meaning that the will of God is that the foolish people's mouths would be shut, or the will of God is that we would be subject. Well, I think it's both. This is the will of God, and it's sandwiched right in the middle there on purpose. Number one, that we would be subject so that people would see the example, you know, that we're polite to the police. You know, we're polite to the governing authorities. We're polite to people in government. There's nothing wrong with being civil and being polite, not being rebellious, not having a rebellious attitude. Nothing wrong with that. And there's nothing wrong with respectively saying, no, sir, or yes, sir. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. You're respecting the office. And by doing that, you silence the ignorance of foolish people. You see, right here, the Christians were being lied about. They were being lied about being rebellious. The word was spreading around that Christians were these rebellious people. Why do you think when Nero said the Christians set the fire to the Rome, why didn't the people reject that and say, well, that couldn't be? Those are the most nicest folks on the planet. Well, because the rumors have already spread around. They had already spread that they were rebellious, that they wanted to cause insurrection, they were zealots, all of these lies. Well, what does God say here that will silence the mouths of these foolish people? Good behavior. Doing what's good. Don't be rebellious. As a Christian, how is your witness? How is your witness if you pick and choose what laws you obey, what laws you don't? Does the law contradict God's word? Does it contradict God's priorities? If it doesn't, we are to obey it. We are to obey it. By submitting to the government, Christians demonstrate that they are good citizens and not anarchists. We demonstrate God and His order. And then they can extinguish the criticisms of those who are ignorant and revile against them. Peter was not merely concerned about the outward actions of believers, but also the motivations that inform their submission. Why do we submit to anybody? Why should a wife submit unto her husband? Why should a man submit himself under the eldership of elders in a church? Why should these things take place? Number one, because we are subjects of God. It's for God's sake. Think about marriage in chapter 3. We're going to get into this a little bit more, but You know, whether or not my wife submits under to my leadership has nothing to do with me. It has nothing to do with me, and I should not go to her and say, hey, look, read it, babe, right here, submit. I'm in big trouble. My mother-in-law's sitting right there, too. No, that's between her and God. Whether or not she obeys him, not me. Now, it also says for the husband to love your wife. It does not say love her if she's nice to you, if she's respectful to you, if she makes your breakfast. Love her if she keeps the house clean and she doesn't nag you. Then love her. No. It says love your wives. Regardless. It doesn't say anything about whether or not she's earned it or has to do anything to earn it. The very fact that she is your wife means you are to love her and lay your life down for her. Why? Because out of submission and love and worship for God. So, does the Christian submit himself under to the governing authorities just because he's weak? No, because he knows he is a subject of God first. God has asked me to do this, and therefore I do it. I obey the laws of the land. I'm respectful to the office of governing authorities. Why? Because those were created and ordained by God for order. Sometimes we are given godly leaders. You see it in the Bible. And the society, the nation is blessed. And sometimes we are given evil, disobedient leaders. Why? I believe as a judgment of God upon the people. Because the people have rebelled against God. God said this when it came to the king. They said, we got to have a king. We got to have a king. Give us a king. Everyone else has a king. And God said, I'm your king. Oh, yeah. We don't care about that. We want a king. And God says, well, the king's going to tax you. He's going to take your stuff. He's going to punish you. The king's going to be harsh with you. Oh, yeah. We hear you. We don't care. Give us a king. God said, okay. We'll give you a king then. We'll give you a king. And they got Saul. It was a mess. And then you go on throughout. Look at these evil men who have just surrounded themselves with evil people and took advantage of the people. It's because the people became complacent. You want somebody to lead in our land? You must go before the Lord in prayer. You must beg God for that leader. We didn't. We want a king. We wanted a king, a savior to change things. Yeah, things really changed. They've really changed, folks. Our country's a lot better. I'm being facetious. You know what our greatest export is in this country? Pornography. That's our greatest export. But yet, the Gallup polls say 75% of us love the Lord. It starts with the house of God. It starts with yourself, your own obedience to God. We can submit unto the government because we are strong in Christ. But that does not mean that we'll follow absolute ordained governing laws from the government. If they contradict God's word, we will stand against it. We are called to. And you know what? That might get you killed. That might get you thrown in prison. We read the Bible as if it's like some fairy tale. This is reality, folks. This stuff really happened. And it's really happening in other countries. Right now, Christians are having their heads cut off because they live in a place with Sharia law. Don't you realize they want to bring Sharia law to the entire world? Read the book of Revelation. It's scary. You know what they do to the saints? They cut their heads off. Now, we are to make decisions that are right, good, and righteous. And how do we do that? Well, the Bible says here in verse 16, live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover up for evil, but living as servants of God. It says that the voices will be silenced of ignorant and foolish people. What does that mean? Ignorance. Ignorant means the lack of knowledge. They cannot see. They're foolish, right? The cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, 1 Corinthians 1:18. So these people who revel against us as Christians, and they revel against other believers, and they say those believers are crazy, they're freaks, there's something wrong with them, they're Bible thumpers, or whatever else they want to call us, they're silenced when they say these things about us, but yet our lives demonstrate power they know nothing of. When your marriage looks as it's supposed to look, the loving dance of respect and love like Christ in the church, the non-believing, dying, ignorant, foolish world sees that, and they don't know what to make of it. So, we live our lives in obedience, keeping watch over our own conduct when we are around outsiders or Gentiles, because they see the power of God in our lives. They see the power of God when we obey when it's not easy to obey, to bless when we've been cursed in the workplace or at work. There's something different. There's a book called The Heavenly Man. I encourage you to go and buy it. Brother Yun in China during the 50s, when the law of the land was that the Bibles were illegal, Christian churches, unless they were state ordained, were illegal. This man was arrested. He was thrown in prison. He was kept by guards, and these guards threw him in a urinal and would relieve themselves on him day in and day out. And all he kept doing was praying and blessing them. And those men were converted to Christ because of his unconditional love. I mean, to have a heart like Stephen, when they are throwing rocks to crush his head, he looks up at heaven and he says, forgive them. But they don't even know what they're doing. I want a heart like that because my heart's not like that. My heart's like, you throw a rock at me, we're gonna have physical contact. You know, I need a heart that blesses those who curse me. That comes with submission to God first. That's true strength. It's easier when someone punches you on the right cheek to turn and punch them back. It's easier to do that. It takes more strength, more power to restrain that and pray for them. That's the Sermon on the Mount. That's Christianity. That's radical Christianity. And it's not easy, but it can be done through the Lord and His power, through the fruit of the Spirit of self-control. Now, we have been set free. Therefore, the truth is no longer veiled to us. We have the ability now to seek righteousness and make right decisions, to choose not to go and do foolish things at the bar on Friday and Saturday, which ruin our witness to show that Christ is supreme in my life and not alcohol. We have the ability now to reject things like marijuana and say, no, God calls me to live soberly. God calls me to live alert. God calls me to submit unto the governing authorities. I'm not going to choose to do these things which will hurt my witness and show to my own heart that God is no longer supreme, but what I choose to do is better. It gives me more than what God does. I don't believe God when He says to be filled up on the Holy Spirit. I don't believe God when He says, I will give you joy unspeakable. No, because I'm not experiencing that. Therefore, I don't believe it. I got to go and do this, this, or that, or this. You know, it talks, there's a lot of stuff going on right now about child trafficking and sex slavery and things like that. And it's not a fun thing to talk about, but it's a reality. It's a billion-dollar industry. You know, there wouldn't be no industry if we would raise our sons up to be men or our daughters to be ladies and women. You know, if our ladies who are growing up acted like ladies and didn't give a second to the immature little peepsqueak, guess what? Those boys would have to change, wouldn't they? They would have to begin to respect young ladies if young ladies demanded respect and knew that they were worthy of respect. Things would change in our society. And it starts with the house of God. We are no longer blind. We are set free to make decisions that show that Christ is supreme. We have the ability now to reject temptation and totally accept God in His power and say, "You're right, Father. Apart from you, I can do nothing. Therefore, I will abide in you and you in me. I in your word and your word in me, and I will stand upon that strength and that truth. I'm not getting up off these knees until I am infused with your power, because I know once I get up, the temptation will overcome me. So I'm not moving. I don't care if I stay here until you come, God." Those type of prayers. We can't. Something's coming on in 30 minutes on TV. We got to watch it. You know? We got things we got to do. That laundry is piling up. I can't pray. We are free. We are no longer ignorant. We are no longer in darkness. We've been set free from the domain of darkness. We have been brought into the domain of light. And therefore, we have no excuse. We have God's word. We have a church. We live in a country where it's still free for me to preach the name of Jesus. And I don't have to worry right now. Let's not neglect that. Let's not be indifferent towards that. Let's embrace that. Let's embrace that as a church, as a people. Let's obey God. Let's live our lives in such a way that people see our home, they see our family, they see our daily lives as individuals, and they want some of that. Look, some won't. Some will reject you, some will still ravel at you, and that's okay. We'll bless them, we'll pray for them. But you know what? Some are gonna say, What is so different about you and your marriage? Why are you guys so happy? Why are your kids so well behaved? I say, you're not looking at my boys. No, you guys are, I have good boys. I'm blessed, very blessed with good boys. Now, where it says here, don't use this as a cover up for sin. What that means is just because we're free doesn't mean that we can just go and participate in anything and everything we want. And this was kind of a teaching that was creeping in. The Gnostics was a group of people who taught Christians, hey, your body, The physical body, it's sinful. It's always going to want sin. That's just a fact. So don't fight against it. You're saved by grace. Okay, the blood of Christ has cleansed you. Your physical body's evil. God's going to fix that when He comes back. But don't fight against your evil desires. You can't win anyway. So go. Have fun. Live a little. Indulge. And not far down the line, the church began to teach this nonsense. Hey, St. Peter's Cathedral, we need to build this thing. It needs built. Hey, and it costs money. How can we build this upon money? I got it. I am the Pope. I have the power to cause people to be forgiven. Therefore, hey, before you go out this weekend and visit the tavern and the brothel, you just put a little money here, and I'm going to give you a little certificate of indulgence, and your sin will be forgiven. I mean, this is the stuff that caused the Reformation. This really happened. So he's saying, don't live in a way that would make you cause to say, hey, well, grace abounds. Let's sin. Sin it up. No. What that shows is that you have no regard for the sacrifice of God and His Son for you. That makes no sense. The argument is like this. I'm married. We have rings. We had a marriage ceremony. We love each other. But divorce is an impossibility. She'll always love me. So why not just go around with a bunch of other women? We think, well, that's crazy. That's stupid. That's what we do, folks, when we say, hey, there's the grace of God. It's Friday, and I'll say, ask for forgiveness on Sunday. That's ridiculous. The Bible compares our relationship to God like a marriage. And when we turn from Him to participate in the passions of the flesh, it's spiritual adultery. Now, before we close, I want us to look right here in verse 16. Live as people who are free, okay? Not in the law. Don't carry no law, and don't be part of a church who tells you you can't do this, X, Y, or Z. You know what you can't do. It's right there written by God, not by me. Okay, I'm not going to tell you you can't go to a dance or you can't wear pants or you got to wear your hair in a certain way. Don't come here half-dressed. The Bible says that. Okay? But I'm not, this is not going to be a church where it's going to be passing out a bunch of laws and you can't go to the movies and stuff like that. It's nonsense. You know the Word of God. Do what it says. But listen to what it says. Live as people who are free. So that freedom should cause you to be full of joy. Not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Right here. But living as servants of God. The word is doulos. The Greek means slaves. So we are slaves of God. So he says in one way, be free. And the other way, be slave. Well, here's one thing you have got to get it. Write it down. Go home and study about it. And if you don't understand, ask God to reveal it to you. The only true freedom in the entire universe is as a slave of God. We have the word slave and it just strikes a negative thing in our heart. It's a negative word. To be a slave of God is to walk in His righteousness. You see, God would never have you or command you to do anything that would be wrong. So therefore, if you're a slave to God, everything you do is pure and is good and is holy. It's wonderful. Live as a slave of God. And this is what Paul meant when he said in Romans 6 when the question was asked, hey, if grace abounds, why don't we just go on and sin? He says, how can one who is dead to sin still live in it? Do you consider yourself dead to sin? Think about it. If you do, that means that you have got to choose to live as a slave to God. Live in freedom. Live in His freedom through His power. And don't just get so focused. Sometimes I do this. I get focused on a certain sin. Well, I got to get past this one, then I can move on to the other ones. You know, one's more powerful or bigger than the other one. No. Be quick to ask for forgiveness in your home. When you respond harshly to your spouse, your children, or your parents, be quick. I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? When you turn against God on Friday night, you're quick to run to the cross, not as a license to sin, but as hope that you are forgiven and that you can overcome. When it's a Wednesday and you're by yourself and you choose to look at something you know is completely evil and abominable towards God, you don't stay there. You get your butt up and you run to the cross. You receive His blood. You ask for His power and His forgiveness. You get your butt around other Christians. You don't walk alone. If you're alone, you will be a casualty of Satan. And very clear about that. Very clear. Now, the last part of the verse 17. Honor everyone. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the emperor. Now, where it says honor everyone, the verb there is in the aorist tense, which means that there's no time associated with it. It's very, very interesting that Peter did this because all the other ones, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor, are in the present tense, which means it means basically it should be translated this way. Keep loving the brotherhood. Keep loving the emperor or honoring him. Keep fearing God. This is something that you're continuing to do. But honor everyone first is what he says, is that you respect everybody. There's no reason why you cannot be respectful. Even if the person has upset you, you can respectfully speak to them. You don't have to fly off the handle and say a bunch of stuff that you're going to regret. You can respectfully say, no, I do not agree with what you just said. You can respectfully say, I am sorry. What you're saying is wrong. I do not agree with that. And you can correct them respectfully. You do not have to lose self-control. And when you do that, you're going to be different because people lose self-control. They fly off the handle. I know I have. This is what it's saying. Honor everybody. Respect everybody. Love. Agape. Unconditional. Love the brotherhood, meaning the Christians, the family of God. Love each other. Love each other. And you can't love each other if all you do is sit a chair away from each other every Sunday. That's not loving. That's not obeying the scripture. You have to get into someone's life. You have to know what's going on. That means you have to live transparent lives too. Oh, I don't like all this. This is all uncomfortable. That's called Christianity, folks. It's in the Bible. You start in Romans and you go to Jude. It's very clear on how we're supposed to live our lives. Transparent, humble, loving. You love the family of God first. People say, well, it's not all about you. You're right, it's not. But if your household isn't healthy, then you can't be healthy on the outside of your home. You can't be. We can't go running around doing things for God if we're not healthy here. We'll be just like the Jews who were, what, holy on the outside, but on the inside were rotting bones. Jesus called them that. You're like whitewashed tombs. Let us never be that. Love the brotherhood. Love the family of God. Fear God. That's the theme in the last verse, closing it all up. How do we submit unto the governing authorities? Because we fear God. Because we love Him. He loves us. We are subject to Him. We belong to Him. We are His slaves. And therefore, if He's ordained a government, I will submit myself unto it as long as it does not ordain things that contradict the Word of God. If we are ordered someday to go around killing other people, then I'm sorry. I'm sorry. What if there were Christians within the German community. They called themselves followers of Christ. But yet, what'd they do? They slaughtered innocent people. Look at the Inquisition that went on. These were supposedly Christian people killing because the state ordered it. No, we are to obey the state only as it submits and is in accordance with the Word of God. That's very clear. And the submission is never absolute, and it's never a sign of weakness. It's a sign that we belong. Listen, we're sojourners here. Right? So in reality, the ways that the government and stuff does their things, we're citizens of a whole nother universe here, folks. But we are sojourning here. So our obedience here matters. It matters. Honor the office. At the very end, honor the emperor. I don't care who's in presidency. I can have my own personal opinion whether or not I like him or her or not. I judge people by the fruit. But I can still call him Mr. President or Miss President, whatever it's going to happen. I sure know who I would like to win. I sure wish that there was other folks running. But I don't get to pick. I don't get to pick. But I can honor the office. I can be respectful when I'm in a conversation at the water cooler at work. I don't have to go and slander everybody. I can be respectful. We can talk about issues too. Just because you're Christian and just because you're nice and just because you're humble doesn't mean you have to, be Betty Crocker and everything's got to be, rainbows and butterflies. You can have respectful conversations about facts. People say, oh, don't talk politics. That's our problem. We don't talk politics. That's our problem. We don't talk religion. Why? Because what happens, people's emotions get involved and we fight. Rather than, let's just have a conversation. I try every time I meet someone who supports Bernie Sanders or some of these other folks, I'm not trying to argue with them. I'm really curious about the issues. What is it that you support? And we start having a dialogue. I had somebody who was way, way far left. I'm more of a moderate person myself. But they said, you know, this is the first civil conversation I've had with someone who I would consider a right-wing nut job. That's what he said to me. So, wait a minute, did you just insult me? Anyway, or should I take it as a compliment? I don't know. Okay, let's close. I've gone way over.